So, in section one, we discussed the most important observations about cognitive functioning in people with 22q. In this section, let's focus on what this may mean in terms of implications for daily living and clinical care. I asked my colleague, who is a pediatrician working in an academic hospital and head of the 22q outpatient clinic, how he feels that cognitive functioning plays into the lives of his patients and into how he provides their healthcare.
Hi there, my name is Michiel Hoebe and I'm a general pediatrician working as the head of the 22Q11 outpatient clinic in our children's hospital. And as a medical coordinator, I'm involved with following up on children concerning their growth and development. And we know that it's really important to have a good understanding of both the physical and the mental profile of our children. Because that's important to really understand what's going on in growth and development. And that's not only the case if we look at the behavior or the problems of children in clinic or when admitted to hospital, but also if, for instance, we look at how they function at home or at school or with friends. The interplay between mental functioning or difficulties and physical problems in pediatrics is really important. For instance, if you look at bodily pain or fatigue during or after exercise or sleeping problems in younger children, we know that we really should have a look at physical problems that may cause these things, but also look at the mental profile, because we know that actually most often both domains are involved. And for me myself, I tend to really easily overestimate these children. For instance, if I have a discussion or a talk with them, these children can talk rather easily after a certain age. And then I tend to overestimate their cognitive function. And if I'm aware of their real profile by working together with the psychologist in the hospital, then I can change my voice and the sentences that I use so that the children are more able and capable of understanding what I really want to tell them.
So actually, this pediatrician, who is not even primarily concerned with the cognitive levels of his patients, points out a few very important issues already. First, the interplay between somatic and mental development and health. And second, the importance of adjusting your behavior and your speech to match that of the child. And to be able to do just that, having insight into the cognitive profile is necessary. Now, it can be very helpful to remind ourselves that IQ can inform us of the mental age, so to say, of a child or adult. So a child may be 16 years old, for example, but if their IQ is 70, their mental age is around 11 years old. So that means even though they're physically 16 years old, their mental capacities are comparable to that of a typically developing 11-year-old. And that is important and helpful information in knowing how to address a child and knowing what to expect of them. Indeed, one of the key recommendations for clinical care for individuals with 22q is to have regular and comprehensive cognitive assessments, preferably with a complete IQ assessment. Now, of course, how regular those assessments can be is partially dependent on the healthcare and school systems of specific countries. But based on our current knowledge about cognitive development in people with 22q, we recommend to do a complete cognitive assessment at the very minimum before moments of transition. So, for example, before going to primary school, before secondary school, and before reaching adult age. But even after that, continued monitoring every few years is highly recommended. The aspect of the cognitive assessment being comprehensive is also particularly valuable. So you may recall how we discussed that the IQ profile in people with 22Q is often discrepant, with large differences between the different components of IQ. Specifically, and especially in children, the verbal IQ is often higher than the performance IQ. That means that children with 22q generally have better language-related skills compared to how well they can oversee novel or complex situations, such as in traffic or at school, for example. In addition, often their short-term memory is a relative strength. So that means that they're likely pretty good at remembering and reproducing simple information. For example, an easy task such as put on your shoes. However, integrating such a simple task in a more complex context, for example, when the shoes are still in the garden and the child is asked to first also go to the bathroom and wash their hands before putting on their shoes, it becomes much more challenging and will likely lead to frustration. The observation that there are often such substantial differences between the different cognitive domains and that verbal skills and simple memory skills are often much stronger than more complex processing skills has a very tangible consequence. We will tend to overestimate a child with 22q. Based on these relative strengths, we are likely to assume that the rest of their cognitive abilities will be at a comparable level, because that is the case for most people in the general population. And it is an important insight that we cannot do this in children and adults with 22q. We cannot assume an overall level of cognitive skills based on one relative strength that we may observe. So basically, it is highly relevant to be aware of an individual's cognitive profile, as it helps in understanding their individual profile of strengths and weaknesses. And it is beautiful, really, that we can use this information from a cognitive assessment to better understand and help an individual. That's important for every person, actually, whether they have 22q or not. However, for people with 22q, it is particularly challenging and particularly important. Now, it's particularly challenging because, as we discussed, the cognitive profile and how it develops over time is more dynamic and discrepant than for most other people. And those changes and differences may not always be visible. In addition, we should also not forget that this complex cognitive profile exists in the context of many other physical challenges that an individual with 22q may experience as well. And why I said that it is particularly important to understand this profile of strengths and weaknesses for someone with 22q is because of their genetically driven elevated risk for psychiatric problems, which can be triggered by a situation of chronic stress. So in other words, someone with 22q has a higher a priori risk of developing a psychiatric disorder, such as a psychotic illness, than someone without 22q. And the situation whereby this individual is consistently under too much stress, for example, because too much is being asked of them in a school, work, or home setting, that may trigger the development of psychiatric symptoms. And for that reason, it is of particular importance to understand this individual profile of strengths and weaknesses in someone with 22q. As to help to adjust the environmental demands to this, so that there is what we call mental balance. And there is also so much power in identifying someone's strengths. So in children with 22q, those may often be music or animals. Many children I know are incredibly great with animals, for example. And into looking how we can further develop and make use of these strengths. This concept of mental balance and how awareness of one's cognitive profile can help in finding and maintaining it touches upon another relevant recommendation, that of regular monitoring of possible emerging psychiatric problems, which we discussed in more detail in another section. While monitoring of any possible emerging psychiatric problems is recommended for all individuals with 22q, in the subgroup with an IQ decline that exceeds what is expected in a 22q population, additional monitoring may be warranted, as the risk of developing psychotic symptoms may be even higher for those individuals. And early identification may allow for early intervention, and that's important as it may help in mitigating or even preventing more severe symptoms of psychotic illness. All right, let's see if we can summarize the most important implications from what we discussed in this section. based on the observations about cognitive development and level in individuals with 22q, an important recommendation is to conduct regular cognitive assessments that provide insight into the complete cognitive profile and areas of relative strengths and weaknesses. This may be helpful to find and maintain mental balance, which is important because in some cases it can help mitigate or prevent transition to more severe behavioral or psychiatric problems. We discussed how people with 22q are very easily overestimated in terms of their cognitive abilities, and that it is important to avoid this overestimation as much as possible. At the same time, we want to stimulate development and focus on relative strengths as well. Awareness of one's cognitive profile helps towards these key developmental objectives. While regular and comprehensive cognitive assessments are important for all individuals with 22q, extra monitoring for emerging psychiatric problems may be warranted in those individuals who demonstrate a cognitive decline more than what we would expect, given that they have 22q. In section 7 of this MOOC, we will discuss some additional specific accommodations, for example, at home, school, or the work setting, that have proven helpful for many individuals with 22q.